First speaker is Dr. Deepshikha Agarwal, and she has already presented, shared her screen.
Yes, sir.
So we can
sir,
start
would you
with
please
her.
Introduce Dr. Deepshikha?
Dr.
Samresh?
Dr. Deepshikha Agarwal, she is a director of the MGM Eye Institute, and she is a cornea natural segment, heading the cornea natural segment services. She has been practicing cornea since last 15 years. So she'll be speaking on the current concepts of dry eye disease and give the new paradigms. So Dr. Deepshikha.
Thank you, Dr. Samrat, and sorry for delay. My screen is visible.
Yes, madam. Please go ahead.
Okay. I am thankful to Scientific Committee IC and Dr. Samrat Chatterjee for inviting me in this talk. And I will be talking on current concepts, concepts in dry eye disease. So this is of 10 minutes. The topic is vast. What I would like to cover the key points in 10 minutes. So where is my screen?
Sorry to interrupt, ma'am. Sanjay ji, Ranbir ji, inka screen chala gaya hai. Could you please help?
कोई James sir कर रहे थे इनकी screen share.
अच्छा.
Sir, आप ma'am आप यहाँ पे green button देख रहे होंगे उसको click कीजिए.
Share screen.
Share screen करके होगा ma'am आपके इसमें.
Green button के arrow होगा ma'am share कीजिए इसको. PPT खोलिए मैम. स्लाइड शो. म्यूट कीजिए मैम. अनम्यूट अनम्यूट कीजिए.
या या नाउ माय स्क्रीन इज विजिबल.
यस मैम इट इज विजिबल.
एंड माय एम आई ऑडिबल आल्सो.
यस मैम यू आर.
ओके सॉरी अगेन फॉर दिस टेक्निकल इशू. सो
आई थिंक क्लिक ऑन द स्क्रीन
एरो से आगे.
या so why the dry eye is important, because dry eye is a globally prevalent and affects the millions of people, causes wide range of ocular surface complications like impact on vision, adverse effects on the quality of life, and economic burden because of the poor work productivity, physical and psychological impact because of the discomfort, and sometimes it is signals of underlying health problems. So dry eye has evolved from pre-90s to 2017. In pre-90s, it was known as a keratoconjunctivitis sicca. Then in 1995, it was described as a syndrome. In 2006, Delphi group has attempted to make a consensus approach. In 2007, after DFOS and DUS first report, it was defined and standardization of tests were done. Then in 2017, after DUS 2 report, the definition was modified and new concepts have been developed. So if we look the evolution of the definition, first definition was published by NEI in 1995, and in the second definition in 2007 after DUS 1 report, and in DUS 2, in 2017, the latest report has come out, which says this is a multifactorial disease of the ocular surface, loss of homeostasis of the multifactorial disease of the ocular surface characterized by loss of homeostasis of tear film and accompanied by ocular symptoms in which the tear film instability and hyperosmolarity, ocular surface inflammation and damage, and neurosensory abnormalities have etiological roles. So if we see a classification of dry eye, first classification came in 1995. while the in 2007 it is due after due one report it was defined as a aqueous deficient and evaporative. Aqueous deficient is a Sjogren, non Sjogren, and evaporative intrinsic and extrinsic. I am not going into detail. I'm not able to see my full screen. This is coming out. How I can remove?
I'm full screen, man.
Yeah, but I'm not able to see this one. Can I make it? Okay. So the new concepts have been developed over the working classification. In this, they have tried to keep all the patients of symptoms or no signs in a special category. So if the signs but no symptoms, it is a predisposition of dry eyes in a dysfunctional sensations in a neurotrophic condition and differential diagnosis with other ocular disorders. Symptoms but no signs is a preclinical state and neurotrophic pain in no dry eye causes. So if we look at the tear film physiology and pathology, now it is said it is a two layers instead of three layers, lipid and mucoaqueous layer. So three components of networking function of the tear film. The lipid layer comes from the meibomian gland and it stabilizes the tear film and retards the evaporation. While mucoaqueous layer, it is a major component and contains the nutrition and growth factors which provides the homeostasis. Mucin layers comes from the goblet cells and it is a large gel forming mucin and smallest soluble mucins. It is responsible for wettability, stability, and if understanding of mucin will give the future therapy of the drugs. Now the regular secretion of by the lacrimal function unit, it has an afferent arm which is from trigeminal nerve, while synapse from the superior salivary nucleus, while efferent arm from parasympathetic fibers via lacrimal gland. These homeostasis inputs comes from the cornea and from blinking. The tear osmolarity is a central factor for in pathogenesis of dry eyes, because normal is 302 to plus minus 9.7, which is a very narrow range. And factors which influences the tear osmolarity are the increased tear evaporation, decreased blink rate, wide pupillary aperture, unstable tear film, and environment. All these environment means low humidity or higher airflow. All these can increase the tear osmolarity. If we see the underlying mechanism of for the dry eye symptoms, if visual symptoms are because of unstable tear film or and breakup, epithelial irregularities, so discomfort symptoms because of the tear hyperosmolarity, localized symptoms, inflammatory mediators, trigeminal hypersensitivity, and neuropathic firings. And discomfort related to the late blinking are low tear volume, loss of goblet cells, loss of mature glycocalyx, and loss of lubricin. Eye fatigue is because of the unstable tear film. So if we see the mechanism, it is a vicious circle. Because of the hyperosmolarity at the ocular surface causes the inflammatory sequence, then it causes the losses of epithelial cells, goblet cells, and glycocalyx, which causes the punctate epithelial epitheliopathy, unstable tear film and breakup, which causes the evaporative loss and frictional damage to the lid and ocular surface, and again it causes the hyperosmolarity. So it is a vicious circle of pathology. The new concept has been developed about the pain, because pain associated with the mechanical thermal heat stimulation of ocular surface modified by the trigeminal ganglion neurons and cold thermoreceptors detect the wetness and reflexly maintain based tear production and blinking. These neurons project into the region of trigeminal brainstem nuclear complex. Sorry, that is V1-VC. So perpetuation of the molecular structures and functional disturbances in ocular sensory pathways leads to the stasis process and neuropathic pain referred to the eye surface. This is a pain pathway. If we see that ocular targets of dry eye, it is going to be covered by the other speakers, so I am not going in detail. Those are the lacrimal glands, meibomian glands, cornea, conjunctiva, cornea and conjunctiva, and tear film instability. So there are the new concept of the iatrogenic dry eyes. Various these medicines and the surgical procedures can cause the dry eye. Again, I am not going in detail, but drugs are antihypertensive and antihistaminic. If we see the topical, those are anti-glaucoma and these preservatives, contact lens, eye surgeries, mainly of refractive and cataract surgeries, non-surgical ophthalmic procedures like botulinum injection, cross-linking, etc. Non-ophthalmic conditions like graft versus host disease. The lead emergence also play a very important role because it governs the multiple aspects of tear film physiology, tear meniscus, meibomian gland, and mucocutaneous junction. So newer concept developed about the lid wiper epitheliopathy because region of that lid margin that acts as a wiper to spread the tear film and stain the with vital stains causes the friction related damage to the ocular surface, mainly cornea. Newer concepts have been developed over the pattern of breakup time because 5 pattern of fluorescent breakup time, each pattern represents the different pathophysiology and treatment can be targeted based on the pattern. If the area break, which indicates the severe aqueous tear deficiency, while the spot breaks, it is a indicates the local surface wettability problem or it is a mucin deficiency, while linear line breaks, which is because of the mild to moderate aqueous deficiency. And if it's a dimple break, which is again in case of mild to moderate aqueous deficiency or the contamination by aberrant lipids. If this is a random break pattern, then it can be because of the evaporative dry eye. And again, the new concept about the functional visual acuity, which is defined as a function for daily activities and measured by eye opening without blinking of 10 to 20 seconds, which reduces during the visual tasks like reading, driving, working, and it can be it can cause the eye fatigue. So if we see the magnitude of the eye disease, it because of the heterogeneous data, because of the diagnostic criteria, symptoms or signs of both selection of age groups and selection of dry eye tests. So prevalence, if we see the globally, it is more in symptomatic dry eye, especially in Asian race, it's 20 to 54%, while it is, if we see because of the signs, it is higher in TBUT cases, 15.6 to 85.6%. If we see both symptoms and signs, then it varies from 8.7 to 30.1%. In India, very few studies on epidemiology of dry eyes. And at MGM, we have stated that the prevalence of dry eye is 19%, while prevalence of meibomian gland dysfunction 48.4%, prevalence of symptomatic meibomian gland dysfunction is 32.9%, and prevalence of any one of more symptoms of dry eye in rural population 6.8%. Risk factors are many, modifiable, non-modifiable. I'm not going into detail. Mainly age and race, about the computer use, contact lens. We are nowadays computers we are using more. So I conclude to say that the considerable advancement in understanding of dry eye has occurred in recent decades. And the key mechanism of dry eye is the tear hyperosmolarity, unstable tear film, and ocular surface inflammation. The newer concept has been developed about the lid wiper epitheliopathy, pain sensation, and functional visual acuity. And there's a lot of scope for the research to establish the epidemiology as well as for the modalities of the treatment. These are my references. Thank you very much for my patience hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Deepshika, for the very nice overview of dry eye disease and the recent concepts and recent changes that have come. So we'll take the, so maybe you can stop screen sharing and we can take the next speaker and we'll have the discussion at the end. So I shall be speaking on the workup of dry eye disease and how it has changed over time. So the aim of any workup of dry eye disease is to establish the presence of the dry eye in the patient, to categorize the type of dry eye or classify and determine the etiology or risk factors. So who all should undergo a dry eye workup? So people with symptoms of ocular discomfort, which is a wide term to include dryness, eye fatigue, burning sensation, vague discomfort, in some specific groups of people like postmenopausal women, especially those who are on HRT, and also people who are working on video display terminals, because nowadays we have so many people on video display units, then people working in environment where there is high flow or there is people living in air conditioning. Then the third group of patients are those who have specific ocular diseases like meibomian gland dysfunction, after viral conjunctivitis, chronic allergic conjunctivitis, filamentary keratitis, patients on glaucoma medication, or after chemical and thermal injury, or after refractive surgery and contact lens wearers. These are also candidates. And if you have some systemic diseases ocular graft host junction disease, Sjogren's disease, vasculitis, so they are also candidates for dry eye workup. So what does the workup entail? So the steps in the workup are very simple. They entail a triage where you differentiate dry eye from the other conditions. Secondly, the risk factors of dry eye disease, which Dr. Deepshikha had shown a very nice slide. Then the presence of dry eye disease. And fourthly, to categorize the dry eye disease. So the first step is triage. You need to ask questions. And what are these questions? So these questions are, the first question that you ask is, how severe is the discomfort? Usually dry eye discomfort is mild or moderate, but if there is severe pain, it usually means that it can be either because of infection, ulceration, or trauma. Very rarely will severe dry eye cause severe pain. Dry eye mouth, this is a trigger question to rule out Sjogren's disease. Then you need to ask how long the symptoms have lasted, if there's any triggering factor. If it is acute onset, it is usually because of infection, ulceration, and trauma, while dry eye disease symptoms are chronic and insidious. And whether if there is blurred vision and if it improves on blinking. If it improves on blinking, it is usually dry eye disease. And if it does not improve on blinking, it may be other causes. Then are the symptoms or redness much worse in one eye? If it is unilateral, we need to rule out infection, ulceration, or trauma. Dry eye disease is usually bilateral. It may be asymmetric, more in one eye, less in the other. If the eyes itch, then it is usually we need to rule out blepharitis or allergic conjunctivitis. If patients are on contact lens, then it can cause contact lens induced discomfort, which is a total different subject. And that can also lead to symptoms mimicking dry eye disease. Or if there is, some systemic diseases, or if patients are on any drugs, the list of which was shown by the previous speaker. So these are triage questions. This will differentiate people who may be dry eye than people who may not be dry eye. So these are the risk factors. It has already been shown once. So we need to rule out the postmenopausal women and just give a general look at the patient. Things like, swan neck deformities or a very dry mouth will usually point to a Sjogren's or secondary Sjogren's disease. So how do you establish dry eye disease? The definition in says that dry eye disease is related to ocular symptoms. The tear film is unstable and hyperosmolar, and there is ocular surface inflammation and damage. And similarly, the DEUCE 2 report has simplified the dry eye disease diagnostic criteria into positive symptom score plus any one positive sign. And of the positive sign, they have identified three, that is either an unstable tear film, either a hyperosmolar tear, or if there is epithelial or ocular surface damage. So there are many questionnaires that are used to assess the dry eye disease symptoms. Two popular ones, I'll just highlight two popular ones. One is the OSDI, because OSDI, this actually has, besides measuring the severity of the symptoms, it has questions that are related to health-related quality of life. And that is by if the symptoms worsen on visual tasks and how does the environment affect the vision. So this is a very important concept and important part of OSDI, which the other questionnaires do not have. The second is the DEQ-5. The DEQ-5 does not have any health-related quality of life, but it focuses on the symptoms and measures symptoms on three domains. One is the frequency, severity, and very important on diurnal variation. It is known that dry eye disease worsens as the day progresses. So it has specific questions asking the patient if the severity of dry eye is worse at night, just before going to sleep. So we did a small study out here to see which was better in the Indian context. The OSTI, of course, because the health-related quality of life is associated to the lifestyle of the individual. So certain questions related to driving at night, working with computers and ATMs may not be there in the general population, but be restricted to a certain groups. So these questions go unanswered. So the health-related quality of life measurement in Indian context may not be that useful. But the DUQ-5, that does not measure the health-related quality of life. So that is a negative aspect. So in particular groups, you will not be able to assess how environment or the visual tasks are affecting the vision. We found that in our study that milder symptoms were better picked up by DUQ-5, the dry eye questionnaire 5, rather than the OSTI. So then we come to the signs. So once we establish if the OSTI is more than 13 or DEQ-5 score is more than 6, that means they are symptom positive. So once they are symptom positive, the second thing comes to sign positive. And these are the three signs that are there. This, we just need to have one abnormal sign. So tear film breakup time is a very common thing that we can do in our OPDs. And it has, you can use the fluorescein, or nowadays you have the non-invasive automated ones, which gives you a very nice printout. So this is the fluorescein. So you instill fluorescein and then you ask the patient to blink and then you look for the first random spot. So if you look at my arrow, the random spot, this is the first random spot that is there. So you take this reading three times and then you, and if this, if the recording is, if the tear film breaks up before 10 seconds, then it's an abnormal one. So it has to be random. See, now here the break is happening at a different place. So this randomization is there. And of course, now there are different concepts also to that. But this is how a fluorescent TBUT should be done. Then we have the ocular surface staining. We have three stains. One is the fluorescent stain, the rose Bengal stain, and the lissamine green. Nowadays, we use less of the rose Bengal because it stings on installation, preferring the lissamine green. But fluorescent itself can do the job. It can stain the cornea and conjunctiva, provided it has a yellow or orange filter in the objective. Otherwise, the conjunctival staining seen by fluorescein is not that effective, not that great. And so lissamine stains it better. So if you don't have a yellow filter, then you can use both fluorescein or lissamine green. Use them both together. Lissamine for the conjunctiva and fluorescein for the cornea. And this is how it appears. So if you see the staining here, it is much, much better with the lissamine green rather than the fluorescein. And then you need to grade it. DUS2 has made it very, very simple. It has made it simple in the sense that if you have 5 spots in the cornea, 5 spots or more, it is positive sign. And if the symptoms are positive, then you have a dry eye diagnosis made. Or if there are 12 conjunctival spots. So this is a very, very simplified form and which anybody can do. But if one wants to grade it into mild, moderate, or severity, then there are different scales, either the Oxford scale or the Sjogren syndrome for international registry. But the DUS2 can perform very well in a general clinic. One thing that was highlighted in the previous is the lid wiper epitheliality, along with positive staining on the cornea and conjunctiva. Even if the lid margin is stained, like in this case, and in this case, then also it is a sign of dry eye disease. So this is a new concept in DUS2. Then tear osmolarity, this is considered to be a gold standard, but we now have a point of care mechanism, but it is pretty expensive. But people who can do it, this is also a very good test. So once you have established dry eye disease, that this patient has dry eye disease, you need to subtype it. And the DUS2 has subtyped it into three broad areas. One is the aqueous deficient dry eye disease, the evaporative dry eye disease, and other states. This other states is the preclinical state where you may have symptom positive, but signs are negative. Or you may have symptom negative, but signs are positive. A new concept introduced, as Dr. Deepshikha had elaborated, is neuropathic pain, where you don't have signs, but patient is very symptomatic. So tear film height is nowadays, I can hear the buzzer. So I'll try to finish it in time. So the tear film height is something that can be measured in the slit lamp, or you can have either in the OCT, or you can have it in the automated machines. The other is Schirmer's test. So the Schirmer's test can also be done, and we all are familiar with this. You can either do the Schirmer's test one without anesthesia. If there is severe ocular surface damage, you can use a paracaine to do Schirmer's test one with anesthesia. Then meibomian gland dysfunction is a very common thing, and there are some lid margin signs like capping or presence of telangiectasia or anterior shifting of the Marx line. And if you have, or there is irregular eyelid margin, so if you have a score more than 2 or more, it is positive for meibomian gland dysfunction, or the expressibility and the quality of meibom. So you can either have a clear meibom, you can have a cloudy meibom, or in very severe grade, you may have dry toothpaste-like meibom out here. Or you can do a meibomography by doing infrared photography. And here you can see how the meibomian glands are delineated well, but there is extensive dropout in this patient, which is clearly picked up by the meibomography. So in the sequence of tests, we usually go for least to the most invasive so that we don't disturb the ocular surface milieu much. Then there are other tests you can do, like, you know, x-rays, then your serum assessment of antibody levels to rule out rheumatoid arthritis or Sjogren's disease, or you can do a buccal mucosa to establish Sjogren's disease. And there are some point of care diagnostics currently not very widely used, like MMP9, which can also be used to assess the inflammation, level of inflammation in dry eye disease. So a few, two examples that I would like to highlight. One is a 44-year-old bank manager who complained of tiredness, pain, ache, occasional burning, occasional foreign body sensation, more so at the end of the day. And when we examined her, we found that she has significant OSDI, reduced tear film, but TBUT, normal tear film secretion, but she had significant meibomian gland disease. So this is a case of evaporative dry eye due to MGD. And this is a second patient who was a chronic patient of allergic chronic sinusitis, on chronic use of antihistaminic tablets and inhalation steroids. And when we examined him, we found that he had significant symptoms. TBUT was less, Schirmer's was less, and there was significant staining of the ocular surface along with lid margin wiper epitheliality, more in the right eye. So this is a case of aqueous deficient dry eye disease, probably because of chronic allergy and use of allergy mechanisms. So with this, I would like to finish the talk, and I would like to thank the organizers for giving us an opportunity to share our experience in dry eye disease. Thank you. So now may I invite Dr. Sharad Gomase to do the third talk on managing a dry eye patient.
Good morning, everyone. After a wonderful talk by two previous speakers on the concepts of the dry eye and the diagnosis of the dry eye, I will be talking on the managing a dry eye patient. So when patient visits to your clinic after a dry eye question, we do analyze some risk factors associated with the patient. And after doing the diagnostic test, as mentioned by the Dr. Samrasa, we classify the dry eye into evaporative and aqueous deficiency. And we do know that we see lots of evaporative dry eye, but there is a subset of patients which does show the signs and symptoms of the both evaporative and aqueous deficiency dry eye. So this is most important to analyze which component is causing more symptoms to the patient. After analyzing this, we have been given a stepwise management by the DUSE report. Before analyzing to the stepwise approach of the management, I just want to highlight certain points regarding how to scale the dry eye severity. Just to highlight certain points in this, just remember that whenever you are seeing the corneal staining and conjunctival staining are more, the dry eye severity goes up. And along with that, if there are more filamentary keratitis or mucus clumping and tear debris, then dry eye severity level goes up. With this knowledge, I would like to go ahead with the stepwise approach of the dry eye management by the DUSE. In the first step, we try to educate the patient regarding the conditions, management, treatment, and prognosis. because this is most important thing. If you want a patient to have a good compliance, they should know what you are thinking, what you are planning for that patient. We try to evaluate these certain environmental, local environmental factors, which can be a modifier, such as patient might be on a chronic topical medication, such as glaucoma medications, which contains the preservatives, which may cause the toxicity to the surface if patient is having certain things. Certain system of medication, as highlighted by the previous speakers, like antihypertensive, antirepressant, and antihistaminics, which cause the dry eye. If that is the cause, then you can speak to the physician and try to change that medication to other. So decreased blink rate, as mentioned, that due to the digital eye strain, which is we are seeing nowadays more frequently. And so if it is there, then we can ask the patient and counsel the patient that they have to do the blinking in between the while visualizing the display. This desiccating condition and environmental pollutants, which makes the your tear film unstable. So if patient is working in a windy area, then ask the patient that this is the cause for your dry eye symptoms. And if patient is traveling on a two-wheeler without a helmet and anything, that may cause the dry eye activation of the symptom. So these are the modifier environment which we can tell to the patient. After this comes the lead hygiene and warm compresses. This is the most important thing. Suppose you have identified that the dry eye is basically evaporated when it's related to the lead, and lead hygiene is the most important thing to start with. You can do with the Johnson baby shampoo or just a lukewarm water. That will relieve their symptoms. And warm compresses, there are debate whether moist or non-moist, but all works. And there are various manufacturing products are available in the market for the warm compresses. All works well. So this after the warm compresses and lead hygiene, the diet. The diet ask patient to have a good hydration and all vitamins, which gives the patient benefit in a dry eye. To I just would like to pay attention to these omega-3 fatty acids. When the news report was came that time, they have mentioned that omega-3 fatty acids has a role in preventing and improving the symptoms of the patient of a dry eye disease. But later on, this randomized control trial by a DREAM study, which has a primary trial and extension study, which does not support the beneficial effects of omega-3 supplementation on dry eye disease. So it's up to you what you want to give for this patient. After the modification, we do prescribe the ocular lubricants. These are the main visco-enhancing agent in most of the available ocular lubricants. And each has its own mechanism of action. Basically, they just do stay on the surface and stabilizes the tear film. And they helps the epithelial healing. Most important in this, while choosing the lubricant, just check whether your lubricant drop is having preservative or non-preservative. Because if your patient is very mild and they just require 2 to 3 times, that doesn't matter whether preservative or non-preservative. But if they require frequent medication, then better to use a non-preservative. For preservative, they cause the toxicity to the surface. And this is the most common thing, how to choose the lubricants. If your severity of dry is more, then choose a more viscous tear lubricant. But one more thing is that this more viscous tear lubricant causes the sticking of the eyelashes and debris, and they may not be tolerated well by the patient because of their high viscosity. They may cause a blurring of vision. If you think that lubricants are more than 4 times a day, then use the non-preservative lubricants. We try to use the different lubricants with different mechanism of action to find the optimal lubricant for an individual. Basically, it's a trial and error approach in the initial phase to see which lubricant is beneficial to the patient, because the pH of the lubricant and when it enters on the ocular surface gets changed. So certain patients may complain of stinging sensation due to this change in the pH. Once this has been done and your patient is not improving, then we can go ahead to the step two approach. In this, along with the lead hygiene, just add on the antibiotic ointment in case of MGD or antibiotic steroid combination with the anti-epileptics. In trials have shown that either azithromycin or rofloxacin based ointment are equally good effective in managing these disorders. If with the simple warm compresses at home, patient is not getting better, just cross-check whether the patient is doing correctly or no. If they are not doing it, then ask them to compile with it. Or you can do manual expression at each visit, but this is just painful. So just be careful about this. If you have access to DP flow or intense pulse light therapy, then definitely that has a certain role in helping the patient to get rid of their symptom due to the meibomian gland dysfunction. If patient is having a meibomian gland dysfunction with the Demodex, then tea tree oil can be another alternative, and this will help the patient to get rid of their symptoms. And we can advise the moist chamber goggles and humidifiers for the better comfort of the patient. This will retard the evaporation of the DFM. So after this, most important is the anti-inflammatory therapy. As in the first talk, as Dr. Dipushika has mentioned, that the inflammation is a culprit in the dry eye disease, and which is causing the vicious cycle. We have to break this cycle. So at times we have to use the various anti-inflammatory therapy. We have topical steroids, topical cyclosporine, or topical tacrolimus. Topical steroids are a very broad spectrum activity, but you can't use for a long duration because of the side effects: cataract, glaucoma, microbial keratitis. We use the low potent steroids like loteprid or FML for 2 to 3 weeks in BD or TDS doses. Also, if your patient needs a topical cyclosporine, then in the initial phase, we start with the topical steroids, and so that the burning sensation will get better and patient get compliant to your topical cyclosporine. Topical cyclosporine, it's very effective in some certain subset of patients, like Sjögren's syndromes, secondary to any connective tissue disorders. Basically, the dosage is twice a day, but to get a maximum effect, you should observe the patient for at least 4 to 6 months. Before that, you can't say whether it is working or not. Once, if you feel that it is working, then you can continue. And if it is not showing any benefit, then you can stop it. But major side effect is the burning sensation in this. So alternative to this is a topical tacrolimus, which is much more accepted by the patients. These are the newer drops, which are not available in India. And this does show certain improvement in the ocular surface staining and the corneal staining. So this might be a helpful and alternative to our cyclosporine in the future. The next step is that in the to add on topical steroids. But we don't have right now this dicarbazole in India. This is available in Japan and Korea. So coming to the next, the oral antibiotics, as we know that these have anti-inflammatory properties like doxy and azithromycin. What dosage? There are different regimens have been tried up to 3 months to 4 months. So with this, we if patient is not improving and patient is having a severe kind of dry eye, then we give to the step-free management. In this, punctal occlusion, which is the most helpful and effective treatment, and though theoretically it increases the chances of the inflammatory mediators causing worsening of the surface issues, but practically it doesn't seem like that, because we are doing it and patient gets better after the punctal occlusion. The punctal plugs, there is a different classification, but for the practical purpose, just remember that it's absorbable and non-absorbable. So if you want to give a trial whether it is working or no, you can just use a collagen punctal plug. And if it is working, then you can think of whether patient needs a permanent kind of solution. The permanent, you can have a permanent punctal plug or permanent punctal cord treatment. Then autologous serum. Basically, this is very effective in certain kinds of dry eye, like post-refractive surgery, urotrophic, graft versus host disease, and PED, and severe Sjögren's syndromes. Various concentrations of autologous serum drops have been utilized. If just to highlight how the serum and tears matches to each other, basically they are more in protein, growth factor, and vitamins, and antioxidant electrolyte compared to your tears. And this is the best substitute to your tears, as it has almost similar pH and osmolarity, but it has certain limitations, as it requires a laboratory for the preparation, and contamination of drop waters is the major limitation factors for utilizing and universally accepting autologous serum as a treatment modality in a severe dry eye. The next comes the oral secretor box. The European Rheumatology Association.
Just sorry to interrupt. The time is up. You need to conclude. I'm really sorry for this.
Yeah, I'll just conclude that scleral contact lenses are also helpful. If you have don't get better, then step four is the approach. In this surgical option like tarsography, punctal cautery, lid correction, or AMG or salivary gland transplantation. To conclude, the counseling is the most important thing, and aim of therapy is to improve the quality of life of patient and individualize the treatment for each patient, because that is the most important. And treat meibomian gland dysfunction very aggressively, and anti-inflammatory therapy is the important arm of treatment along with the lubricants. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sharad, for trying to give a very nice broad overview of treatment of dry eye diagnosis, treatment in a very short time. Thank you very much. So we'll discuss this later on. Now I invite our speaker, Dr. R. Sudhir, for management of moderate to severe dry eye, role of a new topical gel drop. Dr. Sudhir?
Yes.
Thank you.
Let me know once you see my screen.
It's still not visible. Yeah, it is visible now.
Okay. Can you see the screen now?
Yes.
Okay. Am I audible? Can I go ahead?
Yeah, you are loud and audible. You can go ahead.
Thank you. Start. Yeah. Good morning to all. I'm Dr. Sudhir. I am a senior consultant in the cornea refractive services at Shankar Netralaya. I'll be talking to you about the role of new topical gel in the management of moderate to severe dry eye. As we all know, the dry eye is the prevalence of dry eye is varied because of multiple definitions which have been used. Looking at in India, the prevalence rate is from 18.4% to 54.3%. And it affects more than 275 million people. That is what is expected. Considering this, it affects the quality of life, productivity, visual function. And coming on to the current scenario of dry eye in COVID, because of increase in digital screen time, there's increase in the prevalence, worsening of symptoms, and also because of the dispersion of use of face masks, which causes the rapid tear evaporation and the air to cause more evaporation of the tears, and the frequent drying is other important cause for increase in the prevalence of dry eye during this COVID time. The dry eye is a complex pathology with a challenging diagnosis. There's always an ocular surface damage besides the discomfort. This damage is, there is always a disproportionate between the symptoms and signs, and existing diagnostic methods do not provide accurate information on ocular surface status. And the ocular surface evaluation using current methods often does not correlate with symptoms. And there is also treatment challenges, inadequate lubrication, which results in ocular surface damage and discomfort. And tear supplements are used to treat this problem, but one need to use high viscosity eye drops, which are required to provide sufficient and prolonged lubrication, but inappropriate viscosity can cause blurring and stickiness. If low viscosity drops are used, they are quickly eliminated and needing frequent dosing. So it is a challenge to balance the tear supplements to achieve right viscosity to remain for long time on surface without causing blurring of vision. So, and there is also one more important problem is the compliance to treatment varies from patients to patients. Patients with mild, moderate, and severe, the compliance initially during the treatment, they stick on to the treatment, even though if you ask them to use 4 to 6 times, they may use 2 or 3 times. And this compliance is also being an important cause for not able to clear up the discomfort which they have. So the majority of research has happened in US, and there is a scarce data coming from countries from India. So to answer this problem, the new formulation of extra protection in dry eye is sustained gel drop, which contains demulcents and high concentration of HPGA, which enable the formation of intense gel technology that ensures extra protection against symptoms of severe dry eye. So looking to the mechanism of action, how does it occurs? Looking out to the ingredients, as I said, it has a polyethylene glycol 400, which relieves inflammation, irritation, preserves the ocular surface microenvironment, lubricates and protects. whereas the propylene glycol, which is 0.3%, increases the viscosity, forms protective layer, and holds the water content almost up to 3 times its own weight. So it has high concentration of HP guar, the low viscosity inside the bottle due to pH of 7, and has a high surface tension, which is 54.3 dynes per, and a borate, which has a preservative. How does this work? The formation of intense gel shield is on administration. It spreads easily. It interacts with the tear pH and lowers the surface tension of the eye. It cross-linking of HP guar with the borate results in the formation of a gel intense gel shield technology. The gel shield allows demulcents adhere to the ocular surface and provides extra protection against the symptoms of severe dry eye. Looking at the viscosity of the drops which are currently available, if you look at Refresh Liquid Gel, the current Systane Gel has a viscosity almost 834% more than Refresh Liquid Gel and 115% more than the Siluvisc. So this is one of the highest available viscosity drops in terms of centipoise. So it has almost 654 centipoise compared to any of the gel forming. The impact of Systane Gel drops also has, it increases the tear film thickness within 10 minutes of administration. So it increases almost to 155%. When we compare with trehalose and hyaluronic acid, it is much, much higher. Coming on to the study which we have done in the Indian subjects, and this is a phase three clinical trial, which was done as a 3-month prospective multicenter open label single arm study conducted across 13 centers in India, which included 200 patients with age group of 18 to 65 years who had bilateral dry eyes, tear breakup time less than 5 seconds, corneal surface staining of greater than 3 and shimmer score greater than 3 and OSDI score greater than 80. And they should also read BCVA greater than 55 letters. The intervention is one drop is applied topically into each eye 4 times a day for 90 days. The primary change is measured at 45 days and 90 days, and safety adverse events are noted. Going on to the results, there is a significant reduction in the corneal staining seen in all patients from baseline. So when we see from the baseline to 45 days, there's a significant drop in the corneal surface staining, and this persistent further until 90 days. So going on to looking to the actual values, it was the corneal surface mean score was 5.7, plus or minus 2.2, whereas day 45, it reduced to 3, and whereas day 90, the surface staining reduced to 1.7. So change is seen immediately within 45 days, and that persisted, and maximum change reduction of minus 4 in the corneal surface staining is achieved in these patients. Going on to so the efficacy observed in study was consistent with the previous studies. The one study which we compared was a Cohen et al., which conducted a randomized observation and subject masked multicenter parallel group study, where they compared Systane Gel with Refresh Liquid Gel. They had 73 subjects in Systane Gel and 74 in Refresh Liquid Gel. Corneal surface staining was significantly reduced from baseline to week 6 for Systane Gel. And our study showed a reduction of minus 4, whereas they showed a reduction of 3.3 units. And improvement in corneal staining in the Indian population, which we showed minus 2.7 at 45 days, is similar to the study which they had shown. So from the baseline, you can see at every visit, it had a better reduction in CSS compared with Refresh Liquid Gel eye drops. And compared to the adverse events, there were very insignificant adverse events. Only thing, 3% of them showed experience blurring. And this again, is a very, very small percentage of patients. So the efficacy of Systane Gel in Indian subjects with dry eye is consistent with previous clinical study. No new safety signals were observed on analysis of adverse events. And Systane Gel drops demonstrated safety efficacy when used 4 times daily over 90 days in Indian patients of dry eye disease. So this improves dry eye parameters. So going back to the study which Stephen Cohen et al. Had done, so where they have evaluated and compared between PEG versus Refresh Liquid Gel. So go into details. So you can see at every post-baseline visit, mean corneal staining score was slightly lower in the PEG group compared to CMC. So this was demonstrated, and the change is also significant compared with the CMC. The change was -3.4 with the polyethylene glycol drops compared with CMC. And they also looked at assessment of improvement in terms of symptom score. So they asked about a comfort level. 85% said they had a better comfort when they used cysteine gel compared with the refresh liquid gel. And so this was also showed a better results compared with PEG. And when the patients were asked about the satisfaction about the questionnaire, so you can also see that patients answering most of the time or all the time. So they were happy with the acute treatment with PEG and how long the effects last. Many of them said the effect is much longer, and some of them said completely eliminated their dry eye symptoms, and the treatment used relieved most of the dry eye symptoms. Again, PEG group showed much higher than CMC. So they had a better safety profile compared with CMC. And so this clinical trial correlates with the results what we have seen. So the other important function is the apart from the discomfort and symptoms, is how much is the pathology which is affecting. So this all happens at the micro level. So one need to look at what is the damage which is occurring in the epithelium. So there was a one study which looked at irregularity factor. So using a high resolution OCT, one can actually study the changes in the thickness of the epithelium from center to the periphery and see how does this profile change. So this was one of the good indicator to show how much damage the dry eye is causing on the epithelium. So if you look into in the normal subjects, the variation is much lesser within the 3 mm zone of, which is the most important because that is area of visual in the center of the pupil. And they looked in and they say in the normal subject, the variability is almost negligible. Whereas when you see in the patients with dry eye, there is so much of difference in the epithelial thickness profile from center to periphery, showing that there is causing a damage to the epithelium. So this study, when they used cysteine gel and they also looked how much is the improvement from tear breakup time, shimmers, corneal fluorescence staining, epithelial irregularity factor, which we saw, showed a significant change from the baseline after 6 weeks when they used cysteine gel. So this again shows the improvement even in the epithelial irregularity factor after using cysteine gel. So following treatment with cysteine gel, there was improvement in all measures. They significantly reached with tear breakup time, shimmers, and EF. And cysteine gel achieved microscopic resolution of these abnormalities as suggested by EF. EF has a potential utility as an objective measure of corneal abnormalities associated with dry eye. So we also did a study, and this was recently published, presented in the poster in ARVO. So looking at ocular surface kinetics of fluorescein in human eyes and the effect of cysteine gel. So we wanted to study how long the cysteine gel when administered into the eye stay compared with the normal saline. And so the patients were given fluorescein on one day, and the subsequent day they were given normal saline. And what we did is we mixed a fluorescein with cysteine gel, and 30 microliters was applied on the lower cul-de-sac. And we followed and we measured the fluorescein clearance, which happens using a custom spot fluorometer, where every few seconds, every 30 seconds, we measured how much is the fluorescein level until it reaches the baseline level. So we built a spot fluorometer attached to the slit lamp, and that could actually measure the fluorescein levels once we administered into cul-de-sac, and we can look into it. So these are two examples of two patients we can see comparing a normal saline versus cysteine gel. So when the normal saline lasted only about the fluorescein mixed in the normal saline completely got came to baseline within about 500 seconds, whereas those where we administered the cysteine gel, they persisted almost up to 2,400 seconds. So this is a very good indicator saying that cysteine gel is retained in the eye for longer duration of time. So this is an example of from the second patient, again, where the patient had almost the half-life of, we also measured the half-life of it. So in the first one, it was half-life was about 1,120 seconds, whereas in the second, it was 865 seconds. So we also looked at what is the area under curve, which also tells us the time, how much is the fluorescein which is available on the ocular surface. In all of the three conditions, like the concentration, initial concentration, half life, and the area under the curve, in the, all these 17 eyes, comparing the normal saline versus cysteine gel, showed that the cysteine gel stays in the eye for a very long time. So we leveraged our custom spot fluorometer to assess the retention of fluorescein when formulated into cysteine gel, and fluorescein measurements from the ocular surface clearly indicated increased half-life of fluorescein in normal subjects with cysteine gel compared to normal saline. So currently we are continuing the study with the same with the dry eye subjects. So looking at cysteine gel safety and all that, to conclude, dry eye affects almost, the prevalence is varied, 18.4% to 54.3% in India. Dry eye considerably affects the quality of life. There's ocular surface damage besides discomforting symptoms. Examining ocular surface is important, but current evaluation techniques have several limitations. Cysteine gel drop, a new dry eye treatment comes with intense gel shield technology, owing to high concentration of HPGOR. An intense gel shield provides extra protection against symptoms of severe dry eye. And cysteine gel has high viscosity and increases tear film thickness almost by 155% compared with any other drops. And within 10 minutes of administration, the thickness is increased by 155%. Although high viscosity, only 3% of the patient experienced blurring. So we also found in patients who had blurring, we asked them to apply the drop between the eyes, give at least 10 minutes gap. So when they apply simultaneously, then they may have a blurring, but if they apply alternatively in each eye, then none of them reported blurring. So this is very important in case of moderate to severe dry eyes, where a patient can be asked to put drops in alternately in both eyes with a gap of minimum 10 to 15 minutes. Cysteine gel drop improves corneal staining, highly recommended parameter for assessing ocular surface health. And cysteine gel drop is also effective in improving the epithelial irregularity factor, which is at the micro level, we can see. Thank you for your patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. Sudhir, for sharing your research on cysteine gel with us. Now I request Dr. Samaresh Srivastav to speak on hydrate to heal, cysteine hydration management in postoperative dry eye. Dr. Yeah. Samaresh.
Thanks a lot for inviting me for this talk. And I would like to acknowledge all the previous speakers, Dr. Deep Shikha, Dr. Samrat, and Dr. Sharad for, you know, setting out the basics in right order. Dr. Sudhir, who's also been my teacher at Shankar Nethralaya, under whom I've done a lot of my cornea rounds. I think for us, it's very important to understand, for us all, you know, as primarily surgeons, cataract and refractive surgeons, that one of the biggest factors that affects us in our clinic is patients who are unhappy post-operatively. And these are the patients who will nag us. These are the patients who will, despite putting all the effort, you know, not talk great about us, for simple reasons that either we could not diagnose or we are unable to manage this small subset of dry eyes, which is probably the most important subset of post-operative dry eyes. So I'm going to discuss this in context with cysteine hydration, which is a newer drop, which is coming from Alcon Laboratories, from Alcon Pharma now. And and I'll explain why this should be, you know, this and drops like these should be the go-to drops for these people. So dry eye is common. It follows both cataract surgery and it follows LASIK quite commonly. And its presentation in the clinic can depend. Some studies back in 2015 from Gupta, M et al. Have suggested that up to 100% people can have dry eyes, although I think it's a bit of an over-exaggeration in studies. But it's safe to say that as people age, they will develop various forms of dry eye. So it's the older population that is most affected by it. People above 70, 75 who come with cataracts, and I would insist should all of them should undergo dry eye evaluations, because they do have subtle signs of something happening somewhere. The same, I think, goes on for refractive surgery. And a lot of patients, particularly older surgeries, including microkeratomes, and when the lubricants were not as great, would experience dry eyes. And again, a study from 2005 suggests as high as 95%, although I believe now it's not that bad, but it's still quite a presence there. So again, it's very important to understand that dry eye is not a 1-week, 2-week scenario, and it could be a chronic problem. some patients where it has not been picked up preoperatively and who are at the brink of either meibomian gland dysfunction or aqueous deficiency or whatever sort of dry eyes, it may take up to 3 months or more for the tear film to stabilize post cataract surgery, especially with the larger incision surgeries. And I guess a similar scenario even with patients post LASIK. Sometimes it may even be worse. It may take up to about a year for dry eyes in post LASIK, and particularly with thicker flap microkeratome LASIKs, to stabilize back to normal tear film. And these are the patients who will chronically nag you. And I think this is very concerning to all of us. And we all know that. This is not new knowledge. This is something we've already always known. But it's important to also understand and address the basics. Some factors that do cause dry eye. And I think it's really important to always refresh our knowledge on this. Listed down are four most important factors, which individually and collectively collectively join into compromise your tear film post-surgery. And then we'll discuss each of them one by one. So what is desiccation? Desiccation essentially means pulling out water or drying or dehydrating. And let's see LASIK for now. If you look at LASIK, what are we doing? If you're making a flap or any sort of procedure where we are cutting the cornea, be it SMILE, be it LASIK, we are basically disrupting intercorneal nerves. We do that more with microkeratomes and significantly less using femtosecond lasers, either by using a thin flap or by using a SMILE-like procedure or intralenticular removal. We also damage the goblet cells because significant suction is to be applied on the cornea to be able to hold it, to be able to cut properly. And this does cause damage to goblet cells. And obviously, corneal shape gets altered, although transient. And if you're ablating a large amount of tissue, maybe for a longer term as well. And all these, by one or the other mechanisms, will cause problems. Cutting the corneal nerves is going to decrease corneal sensitivity, which in return is going to spoil your feedback loop of corneal dryness, causing dry eyes. Damage to goblet cells is going to cause less mucin expression, thereby your tear film is going to break up and cause dry eye. And then eventually corneal shape itself, because it's irregular, will cause drying spots to appear far more frequently than otherwise a normal virgin eye. Also, it's very important to understand that during procedures like LASIK, the operating theaters cause loss of humidity because you're working at a low humid environment, and particularly in a place like where I am with Northern India and Rajasthan, your humidity can hit as low as 40% and your flaps can dehydrate and your epithelium can do that as well. So it's a good idea to monitor that during your surgical procedure. Essentially, a similar problem in cataracts, but in cataracts, what makes it worse is the intraocular inflammatory changes. It's needless to say that because you're making an incision, the larger your incision, the more surface irregularity will happen and the more nerve damage will happen. All this eventually reduces the sensitivity of the cornea and spoils the tear film, eventually leading to dryness at that incision site and then maybe at a distant site as well. So slightly different mechanisms, but essentially the picture is the same in both cataract and LASIK patients. The second mechanism of damage or causing dry eyes is epithelial damage. This is something we've not looked at through a long time because epithelium was something that would regrow and we don't pay too much attention to it. But over the years, it's very important to understand that epithelium is one of the major factors, and impaired epithelial wound healing is one of the most common problems that will happen. And these patients, particularly with temporal surgeries, will come and complain to you that it's nagging them at this corner, and that's the only complaint they have. They are seeing well, their corneas are clear, their IOLs are well-centered, they have the best lenses in their eyes. But the only thing that is bothering them is that slight gritty feeling on the sides and at the bottom. And that's probably to do with the way we make our incisions and the type of blades that we use. So again, needless to say, one should not reuse blades because that makes incision worse. But there have been very interesting studies like the one that happened over here, published in Korean Journal of Ophthalmology, that compared superior and temporal incisions and also compared grooved and single blade incisions. And interestingly, it said that the grooved incisions can aggravate symptoms of dry eyes. Also, very interestingly, they said that long microscopic exposures, and again, which essentially means long exposures under the air-conditioned environment with an open eye with a speculum, can cause dry eyes exaggeration as well. And that thing is a no-brainer because goblet cells are drying up. So it's very important to understand epithelial damage. More so in cataract, what we're doing from the top and dehydrating from the cornea because of air conditioning and exposure is one thing. But what's very important to understand is that this is a study that was again published by another group in JCRS, but we essentially did the same study in our clinic, where we looked at central corneal thickness postoperatively. And what did we realize? We realized that immediate postoperatively, the central corneal thickness increases. This also causes the central epithelium thickness to change, okay? And then eventually, slowly, it will start to settle down and the epithelium becomes thicker, but it never really comes back to baseline. Why does it happen? This epithelium becomes thinner and the central cornea becomes thicker. So thinning of epithelium is just a counter mechanism to be able to compensate for central corneal thickness. It happens because of the damage that we do inside the eye. It happens because we forget and sometimes we overlook. And sometimes despite the best technique and technology and preservatives or preserving viscoelastics, we damage the endothelium. And it is this endothelium that causes the epithelium to change eventually, because the endothelial pump doesn't work. The cornea thickens up, the epithelium gets worsened. The epithelium starts to degenerate and dehydrate. And that is what causes epithelial damage in cataract. So it's very important to get your technique and your viscoelastics right as well. Tear film breakup time is something which, again, it's all correlated. So if you've had LASIK done, because you're damaging the nerves and thereby damaging the corneal sensitivity, you are increasing evaporation. Most of the people who have LASIK done are going to sit in air-conditioned rooms, look at screens like I'm looking at and you're looking at today, and it's going to exaggerate their dryness because it's a dry environment and recipe for disaster. Other things like goblet cell damage and altered corneal shape also will add to it, but it's mostly the feedback loop from the intracorneal nerve damage. And I think this is well published and understood. Because of this, the tear film breakup time will drop sharply following LASIK. It will also sharply fall if you don't rehabilitate these patients in time using the right kind of lubricating eye drops, because you're not doing your share. You've done the surgery, but you're not doing your share to help heal the epithelium postoperatively. Friction is another mechanism that works. Friction again, LASIK, decreased mucin secretion. Your lubrication is gone this time. And because your lubrication is gone, every time the eyelid moves, when you blink your eyes with a complete or a partial blink, is that irregular surface. In a LASIK, there's a whole 360 degrees cut. In a cataract, there's three cuts that cause friction at that area, and that will cause the epithelium over there to change. Cataract surgery it is also known that meibom expressibility changes after cataract surgery for up to 3 months. And if you have an irregular surface on the cornea and you have decreased meibom secretion and your tear film is not stable, obviously lubrication being low, friction is going to cause this problem. I think we all know this very well, which is good to understand each of them individually to be able to understand where and how we should hit to be able to get the maximum impact. So how does it work? You know, if you have, it's mostly when we are operating a patient, patients in today's day and time are looking at small things. You know, their expectations are sky high, and that's rightfully so, because we only promise them that we are going to give them the best surgical outcomes and they'll see on day one, particularly post LASIK. And so anything that they will see out of the ordinary, they're not going to like it, especially because the gritty feeling, the red, the constant pinkishness of the eyes and the need to putting drops very frequently. Obviously, visual outcomes will mar, because it's simple to understand that the first refracting surface of the eye is the tear film, and the cornea and everything comes, and the lens and, you know, the flaps and everything comes later on. But if your tear film is inadequate and your tear film breaks up, the first scatter will happen even before it hits your anatomical eye. Abnormal wound healing, person's epithelial defects are rare, but they can happen. Happen more in patients who had vascularizations and are chronic contact lens users. And this prolongs the entire situational recovery process. So what you promised on day one is going to happen on day 30 or day 60, and that's not going to be a good thing. Cataract surgery, we've all seen it. We've all done great surgeries. We've acquired this skill and worked over years to learn this, the cataract surgery skill set. But eventually we realize these patients are not happy. They're not happy because of dryness, and they're not happy because sometimes we fail to pick up the dryness, and sometimes they were at the brink and they precipitated. So most importantly now, what is the solution? Now we have a huge array of eye drops that is available in the market. We have a huge spectrum. We have MRs coming and explaining about the good and the bad of each. It's for us to understand what works for us. And it's very important to understand that the same thing that we caused, the same damages, the same mechanisms that were there have to be addressed. So it is not about which drop comes in a bigger pack and which drop comes in a 20 ml pack and which drop costs cheaper. It's important to understand which drop assesses or which lubricants assess all or most of these problems of desiccation. If it's desiccation, you need to hydrate. If it's epithelial that's damaged, you need to regenerate and give the right environment and the right broth for the epithelium to get back. You want to increase their tear film breakup time, and eventually you want to decrease their friction as well. So for me, I've used Systane Ultra and for the last almost a decade consistently for all my postoperative patients, cataracts every now and then, but LASIK, it's my go-to drug. And over that, the new Systane Hydration, I think, is going to add on to what the losses were with the Systane Ultra at that point in time. And for me, that loss was sodium hyaluronate, which was missing. So Systane Hydration now contains a few things. It contains HP Goar. It contains polyethylene glycol and propylene glycol that Dr. Sudhir has so elegantly explained, but it also contains sodium hyaluronate. And which is the great thing, because this was the missing link that we were, you know, sometimes we had to use hyaluronate based drugs along with cysteine. We had to use two lubricating eye drops to settle down. And I think it is the right thing to do in a right time for all these drops to be, all these chemicals to be incorporated into one so that they provide a synergistic effect. What does hyaluronic acid do? Okay, it's a naturally occurring viscoelastic. Okay, it's not a synthetic structure. It's unlike PEG, it can hold up to 1,000 times its weight in water. So it's a very good hygroscopic agent. It can really pull in water and hold it there. Okay, it has a shear thinning property, so it reduces friction, which is most important. And because again, it has a shear thinning property, it is not as, as thick a lubricant. It does not spoil your tear film thickness and does not cause blurring as much. It tends to attach to damaged acondyl epithelium, and this is published data again. So it's very scientifically proven that it entraps water, makes it better. HP guar, which is a component of the entire cysteine family, but started with ultra and now in hydration, again is a mucomimetic agent. So it acts like normal mucin. So what you're losing out in goblet cells, you are adding back with HP guar. What it's going to do is going to decrease the tear film evaporation. So it's going to take care of the short tear film breakup time. And because of that, it's going to increase your tear film stability. I think it's really important to use this in patients who are using sustained screen usage and patients in high conditioned environments and dry states, particularly like Rajasthan, Gujarat, so on and so forth. And the combination of these will give you what you essentially need. You need hyaluronic acid to pull in the water and to hang around in the wounded areas. You need HP guar to interact with lipids and retain that hydration and to work as a mucomimetic. So put together, they address all the four problems. They enhance the hydration, they increase retention, re-epithelization, and thereby preventing the dry eye problems. But what's also important to understand that you don't need to put a high dosage of these. You don't need to put them at an hourly to hourly basis because it has good retentive properties. For me, a four times maximum dosage post-operatively would do very well. When you look at desiccation protection, again, hyaluronic acid, this is just a small repetition to re-emphasize the fact that hyaluronic acid with HP guar causes good water retention. So anything that will pull water on the epithelium is going to hydrate the epithelium. It's not going to cause desiccation and not going to cause epithelium problems. There's been a study by Dr. Rangarajan et al. They've compared the drugs separately. If you look at it over here, there's HPGL hyaluronic acid. And if you combine both hyaluronic acid and HP guar, you have a significantly higher amount of viable cells compared to both the drugs acting individually, which I think is again a no-brainer. For epithelial regeneration, again, we've known hyaluronic acid is a key component in extracellular matrix and it's a very regenerative drug. And HP guar, because it sticks to areas, causes synergistic effects. Again, a lot of formulations of hyaluronic acid were tried in a study done elsewhere, published at the APO in Taipei long back. And it shows that if you combine HP guar with hyaluronic acid, particularly this combination, you have a very good re-epithelialization rate compared to other drugs. And this essentially is the same thing. For short tear film breakup time, we've all seen HP guar increases the tear film breakup time. And this was again significantly proven by various studies that your tear film breakup time is going to go significantly higher compared to any other drug if you use a combination drug of hyaluronic acid and HP guar together. And again, this has been extensively published and this has been very objectively assessed. If you look at it again, Dr. Dangarajan's group et al. Have said this quite often. So, I mean, what's important to understand at this point in time for us as scientists is that dry eye is common and we need to do what we can to be able to prevent post-operative complications and post-operative unhappy patients. We've understood the mechanisms of action of dry eyes and how we incite damage, but we also understand what drugs we have to use and how we have to use them to be able to address them individually and collectively. As a clinician, for me, cysteine family, hydration now, which I've had limited exposure with, and I've tried it in a few patients, I have had patients that have been really happy because it addresses the problems individually and collectively. Like I said, it's very important to find out what the problem is and only then and then you'll be able to make the right choice when it comes to your patients. Also, I don't like to bombard patients with drops on an hourly to hourly basis. So I like to use a drop which can give me best action, long-term duration benefit, and can cause lesser frequency dosage. That would be my go-to drug. And I would normally lubricate my patients for a period of about 6 to 8 weeks, which is again what is recommended. And I think most of my patients with simple cysteine ultra did well, but I think with cysteine hydration, I will look forward to maybe reducing this dosage from 8 weeks to 6 weeks period, because the lesser you put the drops, the better it is for the patient and the better it is for you. And we hope these patients don't turn up in your clinic again. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Samaresh, for your very nice description of the mechanisms underlying dry eye following refractive surgery and cataract surgery. So thank you very much. And are there any questions? Are there any panel? Are there any viewers? There are two attendees. Yeah, Dr. Parchand, Dr. Swapnil, are you there? Or anybody would like to ask anything or highlight any point? We have around 10 minutes for discussion. Till someone makes up their mind, I just want to ask one question. Is that primarily these patients that you have treated with, say, cysteine gel and also with the cysteine group, how many patients also needed concomitant cyclosporine?
So Dr. Sudhir will address this first, I think. So you're muted.
Yeah, since this is a completely a phase three study where we can't use any concomitant medications, since it's a completely single drug, cysteine gel was used in all these patients. So, and that's how we found all the improvement in both the corneal surface staining and all the other parameters. So no cyclosporine was used in none of these patients.
Because sometimes the general concept sometimes is that these lubricants are only supportive. The primary treatment, if it is, say, for example, if it is related to inflammation,
yes,
then you have to have anti-inflammatories. And if it is related to, say, Meibomian gland dysfunction or lipid abnormalities, then we need to use drugs specific for the Meibomian gland, or use lipid-containing eye drops, which are not available in India. So I just want to, because you all are working with all these companies, why are so less, the companies are mostly getting in eye drops of different combinations. It's just tweaking something or the other. So why are the actual molecules like Dicofosol, which is there now nearly for 10 years in Japan and all, or even Liptograst or lipid-containing eye drops are not in India? Would you have, I know you're, because you're working with the companies, maybe you would have some idea on that.
I'm not sure, but the first answer for that being a clinical trial, we were not supposed to use any other drug because it has to be compared with a particular drug. Coming on to the newer drops, I think we'll have biosimilars like what we are getting in intravitreal injection slow, also in India faster, because there are few companies are started working on all these newer formulations. I think from cysteine family, I think cysteine hydration, cysteine gel has very good the spectrum where we can use them. And that the most important is the compliance to treatment. Many of the times the compliance is very poor, and that's what they have handled at this particular cysteine gel and cysteine hydration. The other newer formulations, yes, very important, and we need to use anti-inflammatory or cycloplegics, which are very important, because that is the inflammatory component. If it is not addressed, the disease will start progressing. So this is only supportive treatment. So I fully agree with you.
So Dr. Samrat, to answer your question, I mean, I'd like to pitch in my two cents here. I think that this is the question to ask. The question that you asked right now is the question to ask the companies. I think there are a couple of angles. One is, I think, a clearance from your drug authorities for these newer drugs, and they would want to do their independent trials in India. And I think the second thing, which all boils down to, is the commerce of it. And if it's not a financially viable option for the companies, they're not going to invest so much in R&D in India. So I think if we collectively make noise for this and ask them and request them to come over, we hope some drugs will do come up. And because our continent needs these, half of the continent is arid and dry. So, I mean, if we don't get the best dry eye medications, who should?
Yeah, I think I would agree. So what we need is to make a lot of noise. I think we have one question from our panel attendees out here. Dr. Parchand has asked, how often does dry eye workup needed before cataract surgery, and whether dry eye interferes with IOL power calculation? I think these are very 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 pertinent question.
I would love to take this question. I think it's a great question. So how often do I do a dry eye workup for cataracts, not for LASIK? I'm just discussing cataract. I don't normally do a dry eye workup for a cataract patient. But what I do is, the first thing I do is I've counseled my optometrists for the last 5-7 years. You know, fortunately they've stuck with me for this long, is to observe when they're doing investigations, particularly when they're doing topographies, to look for tear film breakup, non-invasive tear film breakup time, or you know, something when the tear film, when the Myers are distorting. And now they know that anything, you know, that happens so fast is an indicator for dryness. I also do my manual keratometry on my own as the first investigation when the patient comes for pre-op in my clinic. I have a manual keratometer lying right next to my slit lamp. And that is the first thing I use, because that will give me first indication whether the patient has a potential for a dry eye building up. So these are a few things that I look at. I also keep in mind the meibomian glands and look at ocular adnexa. But I don't particularly do a dry eye workup for all my patients. So that's the first thing. The second question was, if I get it right, was, can you repeat the second question?
Yeah. Does dry eye interfere with IOL power calculation?
Yeah. So again, great question. Like I said, the first refracting surface of the eye is the tear film. So if you have a dry spot and your optometrist has done their biometry and they have not paid attention to the tear film, they are going to have bad readings in IOL power calculation, because it's a simple formula. Your keratometry readings contribute to your IOL formula. So if you get a wrong K reading, you'll get a wrong IOL calculation. More importantly, if you put a lubricant, a lot of these optometrists will put lubricants and do biometry. So if you do that, the K readings will change again with the lubricant. So wait for 15-20 minutes for the lubricant to stabilize and settle, and then repeat the biometry.
Can I add a point onto this? The most important thing is, routinely what we need to look at is something called ocular surface stress test. Most of the patient, when they come to us for a comprehensive eye exam, they wait, they get an AT done, they have a paracaine drops applied, then the fluorescein drop, and then they also undergo dilatation drops. So by the time when they come, if you see any kind of straining in the eye, that means the patient is not able to tolerate any of this. So that is one of the important indicator where we need to subject the patient to a complete dry eye evaluation. And we also have currently under publication in cornea, where we have worked on pentacam and all that to look at variations in the corneal parameters with these drops, whether you have put fluorescein or you have put dilatation drops, it shows a lot of variation. And that clearly tells us all the test has to be done. The IOL biometry has to be done in a non-contact before you install any drop into the eye. That is most important. Preferably call the patient on the next day, or you first do all the measurements and then continue with the rest of the tests. So this is how you need to incorporate it in your IOL biometry. If you are doing any multifocal or any special, not special, any lenses, it's best to do a non-con, the first get the biometry and then proceed with any contact test.
I think that's what, like, you know, it means a lot of logistical changes. Like what you're suggesting is would mean a lot of logistical changes. And I don't know how far practical that would be, say, in a scenario that, say, we work in, where in a tertiary care setup, patients are coming from far. And then primarily, we don't know whether they are for cataract or this. But that's probably the very ideal thing, that you do these non-invasive tests before any invasive procedures. I think that's something that we need to think about. I think we have another question by Dr. Sada. I can't see the question in full. It's importance of corneal re-epithelialization in post cataract surgery wound healing. Role of HA. I think that's down your line, Dr. Samaresh. One thing that I would like to we had done a study a couple of years back, but that did not get published. Where we saw if corneoscleral incisions affected tear film parameters. And we found that corneoscleral incisions did not affect tear film parameters. Neither did the patients land up with dry eye symptoms. So that was something. So maybe now shifting to topical, clear temporal, where you are cutting a lot of nerves, because the corneal nerves are coming from mainly the nasal and the temporal. There's a thick bunch there, and the corneal incisions carry quite to the center. So probably the damage to the nerves is much more in our current technique than the older technique. What's your problem?
I think there are a couple of aspects to this. I think truly speaking, corneal scleral incision or a scleral incision would, you know, mindfully destroy less corneal nerves and thereby prevent dry eyes from happening. But it's not only the incision. Incision obviously matters. The larger the incision, the more corneal nerve damage. Like I said, two-planar incision or multi-planar incisions cause more corneal damage, as that has come up with that study. But I think it's not only the incision, it is also what you do during the surgery to mess up the incision. You know, if you're doing high parameters, burning the wounds, going in and out, not paying attention to the tissue at hand over there, that causes more damage. So while there may be very less patients with dry eye with senior surgeons like you, there may be, you might see a lot of surface symptoms in initial practice starting people, because right that time the focus is to be able to chop the lens and take it out, and the focus on epithelium and, you know, the wound integrity and all comes a little later. That wisdom comes after a few years of seeing dry eye patients. So I think it's very important to also look at, you know, your surgical skills. Always look at the incision and keep in mind that you want to use the main incision as less as possible, because that's the main culprit and main reason for dry eyes. And whenever you do use them, always, like what I normally do is I put methyl cellulose in my cornea and even on the incision to keep it nice and lubricated. I prevent dryness over there. And whenever I enter, I be mindful of how I'm entering. To answer the question of hyaluronate, I think sodium hyaluronate is...
Sorry to interrupt, sir. The time is up. We have to move on to our next session.
All right.
I thank Dr. Samrat Chatterjee, sir, for leading this session wonderfully. And I also thank all the speakers for their amazing presentation. Thank you so much. By this, we come to an end of this session. Thank you. Stay safe.
Thank you.
We'll be starting our next session in about 2 minutes from now.
My heartfelt thanks to the Chairman Scientific Committee and the Scientific Committee of AIOS and AIOC for giving us this opportunity to interact. And I thank Dr. Deepshikha Agarwal, Dr. Sharad Gomse, Dr. Sudhir and Dr. Srivastava for their wonderful talks. And thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Hi, Rajanand.
Thank you.